Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. You know me, I've got several videos to do, so I started all mixing them together, so I'll start out with, again, another one. First video, brothers and sisters, praise be the Most High God, who's blessed forevermore. The Lord will give me breaking news for you guys, and this is a breaking news. This is breaking news to lots of people. It's from Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, and it's talking about Jesus on the cross. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. I want to put a link to a song down here, sung by a man of God, Roy Fields. He is a man of God. And God has used him to bring in the anointing in a lot of some places. He's a good man of God, Roy Fields. I put a link down here to this video. And because, you know, I made a video the other day and put a link to a worship video. And the Lord has led me in another one. This one is called Shout Unto God with a Voice of Triumph. Shout Unto God with a Voice of Praise. The enemy's been defeated. Death couldn't hold you down. We lift our voice in victory. We're going to make a joyful sound. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Shout unto God with a voice of praise. That's the chorus. Praise be to God, Most High, Creator in heaven and earth. The Bible says, those of you who were once in darkness have been brought near to God by the blood of Jesus Christ. It says that, you know, God has translated us. That's just like the rapture word. You know, we've been translated from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of his dear son, Jesus Christ. That's what God has done for us. Now, God gave me a text. I want to read this to you. I want to read this Bible text. The problem with people is, as the Bible says, my people perish for lack of knowledge. Listen to me. I want to read a few Bible verses. Now, I ask you to sit down, be still, stop running to and fro, like lots of people keep doing. Running to and fro, looking for visions, when's the rapture, blah, blah, blah. And then you don't even know if you're going or not. You don't even know if you're saved or what, because you don't even know the Word of God at all. Listen to me. It's what God's commanded me to do. This year, 2014, brothers and sisters, as I made a video the other day, this is a year of separation. God is calling all men everywhere to repent. That's a verse the Lord gave me the other day from Acts when Paul preached at Mars Hill, in English they call it, the Areopagus, there in Athens. I made a video about that the other day, and the Lord gave me that Bible verse, and now he's tying it into this. God calls all men everywhere to repent. Now, lots of you guys said you got saved because you made a mental assent that the gospel is true. But that's not what it says. John the Baptist said, Jesus said, Jesus went out preaching after he was baptized, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. John the Baptist preached repentance. The apostles, Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, they preached, repent ye therefore and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. That's Acts chapter 2, verse 38. All on through there it says, repent, 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 repent. Repent. What does that mean? Well, they say in Greek it means to mentally decide that, oh, I'm going to change my ways. I mentally have a new way of thinking. In the Hebrew, repent means to change your ways. So we really have both. We need to do both. It means both. The way you change what you're doing is the fruit of repentance. As John the Baptist said, when they asked him, what should we do? He said, bear fruits in keeping with repentance. In other words, if I'm going to repent of smoking, then I would stop smoking, and then you would see me, Patrick, you haven't smoked in a long time. Yes, I repented of it. But if I say I repented of smoking, and then I'm smoking again the next day, then you're like, well, I'm trying. I said I'm sorry, but I didn't change my ways. I'm trying to stop smoking. And that's a whole other gray area. You can try, and God knows your heart. You're really trying, and you go through some kind of a, you know, reducing plan. I'm going to smoke one less cigarette a day for 2 or 3 months until I'm finished, whatever. God knows that. That's repenting. You're changing your habit, doing all your effort to break the habit of smoking, as our little example here. All right. Listen to me, brothers and sisters. The year of 2014 is going to be a mighty year of what God's going to do. It's going to be a mighty year. The Lord spoke to me on the morning of New Year's Day, the year of our Lord, A.D., Anno Diem, the year of our Lord, 2014, when I woke up, in honor of our Lord, the calendar was made, in honor of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's before Christ and after Christ. And that's what I want to talk to you about too. Are you living before Christ or after Christ? Are you living in A.D. or B.C.? I'm living in A.D. Let's see what, I'll make another video of what the Lord's talked to me about 2014. Let's see. The Apostle Paul is talking to the church at Colossae And in chapter 2, verse 6, as ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, like I just talked about. Okay, we're walking in the fruits of repentance. We're walking after Jesus Christ. We're followers of Christ. Jesus told the disciples when he saw them, hey, follow me. He said, take up your cross daily and follow me. Anyone that does not take up their cross daily and follow me is not worthy of me. It's the words of Christ. Verse 7, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Listen to me. This is a word that the Lord has quickened in me for you, for the church, for 2014. God is going to restore his church with signs and wonders and powers. He's calling out a remnant. And the Lord even gave me, even what I wrote, I got a word from the Lord at the end of the book that the Lord gave me to write. The last paragraph, I'll give you the end of the book that the Lord gave me to write. This is called The Final Boarding Call, Satan's Plan for the Ages and Our Last Mission. Okay, now, this is the year of our last mission. This is it. It's time to wrap this thing up and go on home. It's time for the rapture. It's time to wrap this up. So here's what I wrote. I want to close this book with a word from the Lord, a final charge given to me as I was writing this chapter. Now this is a word from the Lord for 2014 to be fulfilled in 2014 by Joshua's ministry, and I assume it, and I believe it applies generally speaking to the body of Christ. Be fruitful and multiply. Replenish the church with my love. I will infuse you with my love. My love is a consuming fire. My love is furiously stirred for the lost. Tell the people I am, in capitals, I put I am, calling. Come home. The wedding banquet is ready. Brothers and sisters, the power of God is on this thing that I wrote. And even for right now, it's when I wrote it, it was anointed by God. And it's anointed by God right now for you. And this is what you need to tell people. Listen to what I'm telling you. Be fruitful and multiply. Now, in this case, I believe he's talking about the church. Multiply the Christians. Make more Christians. Make more disciples of Jesus Christ. In the case of Joshua's ministry, while I was reading it this time, as I'm just looking at it with you guys at the same time, as the Lord had just spoken it to me, while I'm making this video, to multiply. I already made a video that I haven't posted while I was at the orphanage at the Christmas party and the program of the children that we were going to plant more orphanages. And I haven't had a chance to post that video yet. I've just been praying about it, that the Lord has given me a house mom and house dad for two more orphanages. And the Lord just quickened that to me as I'm reading it to you. Multiplying, making more orphanages. Multiplying, evangelizing people. Multiplying, making more disciples. Replenish the church with my love. And the Lord is just quickening me again. Now, I wrote this like 6 months ago, whatever it was. I wrote this like in June. The Bible says the Laodicean church is the lukewarm church. You know, just like the first one in there, they've lost their first love. The last church, the Bible says that the love of many has waxed cold, has grown cold, like the moon waxes and wanes. You know, the love of many has waxed cold. They're not... They don't have love of Christ in them anymore. They're lukewarm. That's why the Lord said, I'll spew you out of my mouth. Take that and pray about what the meaning of that is. The Lord said, because you're neither hot nor cold, I'll spew you out of my mouth. Revelation chapter 3, the Laodicean church, which almost unanimously Bible scholars believe that the seven churches are the seven church ages, and we are in the last church age before the beginning of the tribulation, the Laodicean church, and that's really addressed to us. We think we're rich, but we're not. Jesus said, we're poor, blind, and naked. That is the American prosperity church. Let's see. My love is a consuming fire. My love is furiously, that's the word the Lord gave me. My love is furiously stirred for the lost. God is furiously stirred to win the lost because he's going after that last sheep, those last sheep to come into the harvest. This is our mission, brothers and sisters. I'm tired of people trying to debate me about all these technicalities, about the Word of God. They don't believe in speaking in tongues. They believe it ended with the last apostle. All this stuff, sitting on those padded pews, sitting back there in front of your computer, blah, 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 blah. You know how much time I spent talking to people that are absolutely nothing but pulling down on the body of Christ when other people who are humble people, who are not, you know, debating, they're out doing something for the Lord. And then all of these people on YouTube, I see them coming. They have all of this debate on and on and on. And then, you know, just like Paul said, don't be getting caught up in this endless genealogy when the people are debating about the genealogy of the Messiah. You know, don't get caught up in all this foolishness. That's what's full of people in churches. That's why the Lord is standing at the door knocking of the church. Revelation 3:22, that Laodicean church, and nobody's answering. It's not the door of your heart, what people keep saying. He's standing and knocking at the door of the Laodicean church, the end time church, before the tribulation. That's us. And nobody's letting him in. He said, if somebody will let me in, I'll sup with them and he'll sup with me. He stands at the door and knocks. We're too busy having these little clicks. You know, then not just these guys on you guys and me on YouTube. We're talking about the people that are, you know, nominal Christians. Like when I was in Seattle, I met a whole batch of nominal Christians. You know, they call themselves Christians. And I meet tons like that all over the place. They claim to be Christians. They have no earthly idea that we might be in the end times. They don't want to hear it. They're living in a little dream world. And they're just what? It's the proper term. It's nominal Christians in name only. They're part of Christendom, but they're not part of the church. And then some are part of the church, and they're the five foolish virgins. These people aren't even the five foolish virgins. These people are outside the camp. My love is furiously stirred for the lost. The Lord wants to win all these people. And that's why when I'm making my videos, the zeal of the Lord is on me. And you know, it's a furious love. It's a furious love that the Lord has put on me. The Lord is all fired up and zealed about winning this last sheep. And the church is asleep. It's like a, you know, does an alarm clock sound good? I hate the sound of an alarm clock, and that is what my commission is on the in the world, by the grace of God, is an alarm clock, an annoying sound. Hey, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up, church. Wake up, you sleepy Christians. Arise from the dead, and Christ will give you life. Tell the people, I am calling Jesus. I am God. I am calling. Come home. The wedding banquet is ready. Now that's to the lukewarm, the backslidden. Now my preaching is, you know, I've done it, and we all do evangelism work. My ministry is not really evangelism to the lost. It's to get the church to win the lost. Over 70% of people are saved through a friendship with a Christian. Only 30% of people in the world were saved in an evangelistic crusade. 70% are saved through a personal relationship with a Christian. That's what I'm trying to get you to do, to win the lost, to do the work that the commission, the mission, the destiny that God has for you, to be awakened in you in Jesus Christ's name. And God spoke to me just this night that signs and wonders have followed my ministry for the last 13 years. All kinds of words I got. There's people from YouTube who I got a word for, even life and death words. There's a sister who's from the Philippines who lives in Louisiana, and she's now moving to the Philippines. I got a word that was a life and death, that someone would die. Strong, you know, it's not something that you want to tell. But the thing that the Lord showed me about Joshua's ministry, about my ministry, is in the past, up until now, I've done it in a private way. In a private way, brothers and sisters. But the Lord has told me this is a year of God will kick up a public display, not only for me, I'm talking about, you know, because God was talking to me, but it's for the body of Christ, for the world, brothers and sisters. God so loved the world, the lost people, and the backslidden. God is going to kick it up a notch. He's going to begin to pour out His Spirit on all flesh, signs and wonders following those. Mark chapter 16, at the very end of the book. Did you know that the devil and his people try to say, you know those texts that I've taught you about? You go watch Tares Among Wheat. What's the other one? The first one, the main one. By Chris Pinto, documentaries. You can see the history of the Bible and how that the Jesuits backed a scholar from Cambridge, Massachusetts who was had been, you know, working with them and found this text. And now they try to, you know, in the new translations, NIV, ESV, and all that, they try to say these parts are not in the original text. They're not in that text that was found under the funding of the Jesuits down there that was being used for fire kindling in some place in Egypt in the 1800s. Yeah, the most important verses of the Bible are removed, all about salvation, the blood of Jesus, all this. Those are the verses that they call in question. Now, this is an example. If you've got NIV or whatever, it'll say these verses are not in the oldest text. That's not true. There's other old texts with these verses in there, and then the one they found doesn't have it in there. Okay. Listen to this. Mark chapter 16. Jesus is speaking. Go ye in all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth is and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. All my Baptist friends, if you're watching this and you possibly might be a Presbyterian or Methodist or whatever, I know a lot of these denominations, they can't even get past salvation. I mean, they took out the songs about the blood 50 years ago from the Methodist hymnal. They can't even get past the born again part. Now, you're Baptist, you got all that, but you can't get into the thing that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Let's see what it says. These signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Now we have to judge Scripture by Scripture. I know why these Baptists skip this. You know, you got your snake handlers. Jesus told Satan, you know, thou shalt, according from the Old Testament, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. You should not put the Lord your God to the test, as an NIV says. You don't put the God to the test. You do not tempt God. So to pick up a snake, to keep it, to say it won't bite me because of God, or drink something poisonous so it won't hurt you, to test the word of God, this is a sin, as the Bible tells us. But what Jesus is saying, of course, we have power over the enemy. The serpent's his enemy. We can have authority. If a snake bites you, it won't hurt you. If you accidentally drink something poisonous, someone tries to poison you, it will not hurt you. That's what the Lord is talking about. Not go out there and test it. You have to have Scripture interpreted by Scripture, and Jesus himself quoting from the Old Testament to Satan, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. So that would be a temptation of God, brothers and sisters. So if you are a Christian, if a snake bites you, you should be able to pray in Jesus' name and no harm come to you. Like what happened to Peter in the book of Acts. On the island of Malta. Secondly, if someone tries to poison you, that's why you should bless your food before you eat. Consecrate it to God, and if the food is bad or someone poisoned it, it will not hurt you. You should speak in new tongues. They shall speak with new tongues. These signs shall follow those who believe. In my name, they'll cast out demons. They'll speak with new tongues. If you're a follower of Christ, you should speak with a new tongue, with tongues. Baptism of the Holy Spirit. And it shall not. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. You should be praying for people, and they should be getting healed. These signs shall follow them that believe. These signs will follow them that believe. That's the words of Jesus Christ written in red right there. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe to receive the Holy Spirit as on Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost. And then several other places, Acts chapter 8, Acts chapter 18, at Ephesus, one of the best ones. As the Apostle Paul said to the brethren he met at Ephesus who were born again, have you been baptized in the Holy Spirit since you believed, since you got saved? They said, no, we never even heard there was such thing as the Holy Spirit. Paul laid hands on them, he baptized them in water, and then he laid hands on them, they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Brothers, and it says they spoke with tongues and prophesied. Brothers and sisters, I'm going to cut this off. I'm going to make another video. This other topic that the Lord gave me. Listen to me, brothers and sisters. I want to read one more verse to you. Titus chapter 2, verse 13. Waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. All those people who, you know, they read all this stuff and copy and paste off of the internet, mindless people, who don't believe in the rapture, they will always say, this is Jesus is our blessed hope, not the rapture. Read the text. See what it says. Waiting for our blessed hope. What is our blessed hope? The appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. The blessed hope we have. My faith is in Christ. I don't have hope in Christ. I have faith in Christ. But I have hope that I will live to see the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why it's a hope, not a faith. Because every generation that lived, they thought the rapture might be in their lifetime. So it's a hope that I will never die, that I will live to see the rapture. But I have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's different. I already have faith in Christ. I don't need to have hope in Him. I have faith in Him. I know that the Lord Jesus Christ owns me, that I've been bought with a price. What does it say? Even in the next verse, Titus 2:14, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession. Listen to this, who are zealous for good works. Now that is a problem with the greasy gracers right there. Now, I'm not talking to you. You know, I keep having to deal with the Judaizers and greasy gracers on both sides. That's for you greasy gracers who are zealous for good works. These signs shall follow those who believe. I believe this could fit into that category too. They are zealous for good works. God bless you guys. I'm going to have another video to make. That was a little word for the greasy gracers. I got one for the Judaizers coming up that the Lord laid on me. And I got into that other thing about 2014. God bless you guys.